checkers game where grandson
mountain, looked all around, couldn't find nobody. Went down into the deepest valley, looked all around down there, couldn't find nobody. I went across the deep blue sea, couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. Nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, no, nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Nobody can heal.
Here we are, brothers and sisters, back again, another beautiful Sabbath day to worship together in spirit and truth. I'm happy that you have connected with us once again as we begin a new preaching series for the month of May. And we want to thank God for all of you being here. As you know, well, for those of you who are in the Kentucky area, the Magazine Street Church family and West End community, for those who are listening in who may not be from Kentucky, this is what is called Kentucky Derby Week and Kentucky Derby Weekend. And you know, horses and hats and parties and all of that goes on in Kentucky Derby Weekend. But for us as Christians, we are in another race where Paul says, let us lay aside the weight that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus Christ, hey, who's the author and the finisher of our faith. And so that's the race we are more concerned with, not so much the Kentucky Derby, but that race where when we run that race, Paul says, when we finish our course, and all who love his appearing will be able to receive a crown. And so that's what we're about. And so we're glad that you have joined in into another broadcast of the Magazine Street Seventh Adventist Church. And as you know, I serve as a pastor here. My name is Dr. George E. Thornton, Sr. I'm excited to bring this new series to you for the month of May. And we'll be sharing what those messages are about so that you can get connected, share with your friends, your loved ones, and tell somebody that the Word of God is being ushered out from this part of the vineyard in Louisville, Kentucky. And so I'm excited about what God is going to do with us in this new preaching series. The series is entitled Night Scenes in the Bible. Night Scenes in the Bible. And I'm going to explain more of that in a few minutes, but that's the series from May 1st, which is the day, all the way to the 29th, the last Sabbath in May. We're going to be dealing with night scenes in the Bible, night scenes in the Word of God. And so I hope that you'll get ready. The preacher is ready. I'm prayed up and studied up and looking forward to God using me in this month of May as I bring to you another dynamic word under the auspices of the Holy Ghost. Well, before we get into our message today, I want to bring greetings from our conference president, Elder Benjamin Jones of the South Central Conference. He serves as our president, and he has a message to share with us, a brief video to share with us about when will our churches reopen. And I know that's the big question everybody have on their mind. When will church be open? And so we want to hear from Elder Ben Jones as you watch this video, and we'll be sharing more with you following that.
Greetings. I'm Pastor Benjamin Jones, President of South Central Conference. I want to say to our constituents at South Central that we are glad to see that you're doing well. Over the last several months, the question has come to us, Pastor Jones, what is the plan for reopening our churches and when will that happen? Our emergency response committee has now talked to all of our pastors and laid out a plan for our churches to reopen. In our first phase, we're asking all the churches who have memberships of 100 and less to review the policies and protocols that we gave on last year and have put on our website this year that will allow you to see the CDC requirements for reopening safely. As you review those requirements at your local level with your pastors and boards and assign people to take care of the various functions, then we're requiring that you reapply, that we might review those things and then approve your reopening. As you reopen, we're asking that you be sure to do it safely. In the areas where there are certain surges and it's not safe, we encourage you to continue to be in a posture of remote worship. It is our plan, if this goes smoothly, to expand from churches of 100 to the medium-sized churches and our large churches. We're looking at this from week to week to find out how this is working. So we look forward to hearing from you. If you have any questions, be sure to contact the conference office. You can contact myself or Dr. Nixon and that team, and we'll give you any guidelines or advice that you need. I look forward to face-to-face worship again and the fellowship of the saints. Stay safe, stay prayed up, continue to serve the Lord, and God will bless us as a conference. Thank you. Be blessed.
In conjunction with that, I want to let you know that our leadership team, our church board, met on last Sunday. We met, and our meeting was exclusively about the reopening process. And the reopening committee, task force committee, brought before us step by step, from start to finish, from opening to closing, every protocol, every procedure, every process to us. And we were able to discuss, to dialogue about it, to tweak, to be able to make some recommendations, some changes here and there. But we took that meeting on last Sunday to just discuss, to make sure that we're covering all of our bases, because our bottom line, as I've shared with the reopening committee, is to make sure that every member, every visitor, anyone who comes into these four walls of the Magazine Street Seventh Adventist Church, that they will be safe and their worship will not be in vain. And so we want to make sure we do that. Now, you asking me when will we open up? Well, we're looking at probably doing a soft opening, and note the word soft, a soft physical opening, maybe around the third Sabbath in May, maybe. And we'll give you more on that. I want to make sure that we tweak a few more things, few more things in readiness. The communication department is going to be sharing some videos with us as a congregation, step by step, so everyone could be on the same page. And so once we finalize those final nuggets, then we'll begin to look at having a soft opening. And that soft opening will be spelled out. I don't want to say what it is or what the process. I will let that be a part of the communication that's coming from the communication department so that everybody can be on the same page. But we are anxious just as you are. I'm anxious. I mean, I enjoy preaching to angels, but I like to have some human beings as well. And so we're looking forward to reopening. As you heard our conference president, we want to stay lock and step with the conference, with the CDC, and with the local officials to make sure that we are all on the same page. So what I will ask of you is to continue to be prayerful, continue to be prayerful, continue to be prayerful, that when we do open up, that it will be done in such a way, as the Bible say, all things will be done decently and in order. So we'll give you more updates, and we thought we'd bring that to you. And keep us in your prayers. Keep your pastor in prayer. And keep the reopening committee team, task force team in your prayer. They've done a marvelous and tremendous work. Elder Rodney Jenkins and Sister Alisa Alward, both co-chairpersons of the task force committee and the subcommittee, they've all done a very fine job. And we put our hands together to thank them for the work that they're doing. And when we roll out our soft opening, we hope that you'll be pleased, but more importantly, you'll be safe. So God bless you on that. Now, I'm excited about our new series. Our new series is Night Scenes in the Bible. And there are going to be some messages that will come every Sabbath from here on out for the month of May. Today, you're going to hear the message. We'll give you that title. Next week, the Mother's Day weekend, we're going to do a tribute to mothers. The message is entitled, I've Got a Feeling That It's Going to Be a Good Night. Now, you're probably saying, what in the world is the pastor talking about? For Mother's Day weekend, I've got a feeling it's going to be a good night. Well, you got to be here next week. Tune in to Magdalene Street Church to hear that message. And then we have another message following that. The message is entitled, Twisting and Wrestling the Night Away. Oh, you old bebop people know that. It's twisting and wrestling the night away. We're going to talk about that, and you'll hear more of that. And then we got another message entitled, Coming to You, in this preview of these night scenes in the Bible. The message entitled, All Night Long. That's an old Lionel Richie song, All Night Long. We're going to talk about that from a biblical standpoint. And then we're going to bring to you a message entitled, One Night Stand. Oh, I know you ought to make sure that you're here for that message. One Night Stand. I God has given me a word to speak on. Yeah, those one night stands. And we're going to talk about that in the Word of God. And then we're going to wrap it all up as we talk about the night shift. The night shift. And these are the messages that we will be bringing to you throughout the month of May. And we look forward to presenting them each Sabbath at 11 o'clock right here from the Magdalene Street Seventh Adventist Church. And we have a featured solo artist with us. He's been to Magdalene Street Church before, and he's partnering with us again. A soloist, gospel artist, extraordinaire, Anthony Wiggum will be with us singing and leading the songs for us on each Sabbath as we bring those messages. So we look forward to what God is going to do, what God is going to share. Pray for me. Pray for our AV team, our brother Isaac Kahn, right here with me. We're joined at the hip. He's done a tremendous job. And just pray that as God give us the ability and the anointing to be able to usher these messages out to not only to the Magdalene Street Church, not only to the West End community, but people from all around the world and all around the country are tapping into the Magazine Street Church YouTube page, website, to hear the word of the Lord. And we're thankful and we're grateful that you're tuning in with us. I want to share with you the scripture for today, and then we're going to bring on Anthony Wiggins to usher us in, and then we'll bring the word of God. The scripture for today's message is coming from John chapter 3 and verse 1 through 7. The Gospel of John, chapter 3, and verses 1 through 7. And I'm excited because I'm holding a new sword that my family bought for me. My lovely wife, Carolyn, my lovely daughter, Courtney, my two sons, George and Justin, they bought me a brand new sword, the Remnant Bible, with E.G. White comments. And what a fine sword for me to use. Oh, I'm going to preach up a storm now, but I thank God. This is the first time I'm using it, so I'm going to be breaking it in as we present these messages throughout the month of May. And I want to thank my wife and children for my pre Father's Day gift. And so I thank you for it, and I will use it to the best of my ability. The Gospel of St. John, chapter 3, and verses 1 through 7. Whatever tablet you have, whatever instrument you're using, I just want to make sure that you're using the Word of God. I'm a King James man, but I just want to make sure that you're using the Word of God. John chapter 3 and verse 1 through 7 reads thusly. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher that come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Most assuredly, I say unto you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" And Jesus answered, "Most assuredly," the scripture says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, unless one is born of the water and of the spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say unto you, you must be born again." That's the scripture for the basis of our message today. Our message today is entitled, "One Night in Miami and One Night in Jerusalem." One night in Miami and one night in Jerusalem. Before we bring on the word, we want to bring on my friend and colleague and gospel artist Anthony Wiggins will sing for us a beautiful song that leads us into the word. The song is entitled, "Morning, Morning." May this song break up the fallow ground in our hearts as we prepare to hear the word of God. Morning.
It's morning, but but your life won't shine if Jesus is not a part of your life. Your days will end with no peace of mind if Jesus is not a part of your life. Oh, the flowers might bloom, your grass might grow, but deep in your heart, you'll always know that it's morning. Your life won't shine if Jesus is not a part of your life. With money to spare, you're not going nowhere if Jesus is not a part of your life. With friends and a home, you still feel alone if Jesus is not a part of your life. Oh, you might conquer all the failures out of your past, but only what you do for Jesus will last. It's morning, but your life won't shine if Jesus is not part of your life. You will never know you are or go very far without him to show you the way. You can never retire enough. Life's too tough trying to find your own
song. What a beautiful song. Morning. 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 If Jesus is not a part of your life, you'll be hearing more of Anthony Wiggum throughout the month of May as we conduct this new preaching series, Night Scenes in the Bible. Father God, we pray that you be with us now, and as we open up your word, we thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. Now, oh God, I pray that you use this preacher one more time. Hide me behind the shadow of the cross, that Jesus might be seen and uplifted. And as we take a look at these night scenes in the Bible, we pray that your Holy Spirit will guide us through every deliberation, and we'll be careful to give you all of the praise, the honor, and the glory, because you're God all by yourself. For we ask it all in the worthy name of Jesus, and all of God's children who are listening in and watching this service said amen, amen, and amen. Night scenes in the Bible. I have discovered that there are a number of exciting, enthralling episodes of night scenes in the Word of God. From Genesis to Revelation, the Bible is filled with night visitations, night scenes, night encounters. And I thought, under the tutelage of the Holy Ghost, impressed me, what be a good time now to share these night scenes, at least some of these night scenes in the Bible. Oh, there are a plethora of scenes in the Bible that speaks about night. One could preach on the night in Sodom, when the scripture says, "Tarry all night, escape for thy life." In Genesis 19, one could preach about that. Or one could preach about Abraham's night vision at Beersheba, found in Genesis chapter 22. Or the preacher can preach from, all of us know this story, Jacob's night of wrestling with the angel in Genesis 30, chapter 32. And then one could even preach on the last night of Israel in Egypt. I wonder what that must have been like. The last night of Israel in Egypt, Exodus chapter 12. And then one can easily preach from the subject entitled Elijah's Night in the Desert, 1 Kings chapter 19. And then if you wanted to preach, you could preach from Jonah's night at Nineveh, in Jonah chapter 4. And then you could also preach from the account of the night with Jesus at Jerusalem, which we will deal with today, in John chapter 3. And then there is Jesus' night on the mount in Luke chapter 6. And then the Bible speaks about the night storm on the sea in Matthew chapter 14. These are all night scenes in the Bible. And then one could preach on the last night of the feast in John chapter 7. Or how about the night of the temptation? Jesus' temptation, Matthew chapter 26. And then also in that same vein, one could preach on the night of agony in Luke chapter 22. Then one could preach, oh, I wonder what this must have been like. The first night after the resurrection, John chapter 20. So as you can see, there are a number of night scenes that come to us from the Word of God. And my hope is that the purpose of this series, Night Scenes in the Bible, as we picked some of these gems out for you, that your midnights will turn into day. And that's what we seek to do in the Word of God for the month of May. Night scenes in the Bible. Well, we come to our sermon title today, One Night in Miami and One Night in Jerusalem. One night in Miami and one night in Jerusalem. Oh, beloved, I've discovered that the scripture teach us and say unto us in Psalms 19 and verse 2, it says, "Day unto day utter speech, and night unto night shows knowledge." In the beginning, somebody say in the beginning. In the beginning, God made light, and so time began. He separated the light from the darkness, and so divided the sovereignty of time between day and night. The bright and the black prince were made equal command, and each was appointed to relieve the other in the endless task of counting the years of eternity. Come on, say amen, somebody. Night and day, they both stand forth as co-heralds to proclaim the divine glory through the whole creation. The one always speaking when the other is silent. And I discovered when you look at night and day, there is no speech, no language where their voice is not heard. I'm talking about these two brothers, night and day. Come on, go with me. Day comes in shining glory from the gates of the morning. And night follows closely with his dusky robe and starry crown. Both preach the same sermon, ever old and ever new, upon the glory of God, night and day. Oh, my brothers and sisters, night teaches us the solemn and fearful lesson of the individuality of our being. Far more than the day, far more than the day. It shows us what it is to be alone with ourselves and God. Have you ever been there? Just you and God in the midnight hour? The night of natural world is a symbol of a deeper night of sorrow and disappointment. And I believe God surrounds us with both that we may feel for his hand in the darkness and find ourselves safe in his protection. Come on, say amen, somebody. Night sings in the Bible. In the darkness of our soul, in the dark night of our soul, if you will, I want us to take a look at two different night scenes. One is fictional in characters, and the other is factual in character. One took place in Miami in a hotel room. The other took place outside of the city of Jerusalem near the slope of the Mount of Olives. One was a discussion and dialogue between four men. The other was an inquiry and interview between two men. Come on, say amen, somebody. One shown in theaters across this country. The other is shown in the Word of God. One scene was produced by Regina King, and the other scene was produced by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. One night in Miami, one night in Jerusalem. One night in Miami and one night in Jerusalem both took place at night. Can I preach it now? One Night in Miami is a fictionalized account of what happened before and after the fight day when on February the 25th, hear me now, 1964 in Miami Beach, Florida, heavyweight boxing champ Sonny Liston met Cassius Clay in the ring for the first of their two famous bouts. Clay emerged victoriously, earning the championship and skyrocketing the career of the man who would later be known to all of us as Muhammad Ali. By the way, he is a son of Louisville, Kentucky, born and raised right here in Louisville. In fact, many of his relatives are members of the Magazine Street Seventh Adventist Church. Muhammad Ali, previously known as Cassius Clay. In Regina King's directional debut, One Night in Miami, she beautifully showcased to us the cinematic screen, a beautiful dramatization of four successful black men. Here they are, Cassius Clay, Jim Brown, Sam Cooke, and Malcolm X, discussing one night in Miami in a hotel room the challenges and responsibilities of being successful black brothers in America during the civil rights movement. Oh yeah, I saw the movie, beautiful movie. And I recommend it to all of you. They got together to chill, to debate, to argue, to celebrate what each one had brought to the table in this thing called life, this thing called the human predicament. These men were celebrities in their own right, but to each other, they were simply friends and acquainted, unafraid to challenge each other's view on the present and future of Black America. That's one night in Miami. Come on, say amen, somebody. Ah, but being a preacher of the gospel, I thought about that movie, One Night in Miami, and the deep conversation between those four Black brothers. And the Spirit led me to another scene, a night scene. One night in Jerusalem, on the cinematic screen of my mind, the encounter between Jesus and Nicodemus. It's right there in the Word of God in John chapter 3. See, this midnight meeting was far more momentous and lasting important than One Night in Miami. One Night in Miami is fictional, but One Night in Jerusalem affects all of us. This one night conference of Jesus with Nicodemus have gone forth with the beams of light and words of power to the ends of the earth and still lives in our hearts today. The words spoken by Jesus to this wandering and solidarity listener that night have already changed and glorified the lives or the destiny of millions. And they have not lost their influence in this world when Jesus makes this powerful statement. You must be born again. Yeah. Oh, I don't know about you, but I'm intrigued by this one night encounter more so than the other one night in Miami, because when I look back over my life and think things over, what I have done, where I have been, and who I've been with, I have to ask myself, and you have to ask yourself, have I experienced this great change which is needed by all in order to see the kingdom of God? Have I been born again? We all must answer that question. Has the old life of sin and worldliness and alienation from God been given up? And have begun the new life of love and trust and obedience to God? Have I turned my steps back from the dark ways of which the shadows of death rest? Am I now walking in the heavenly path upon which the favor of God shines for everlasting and everlasting? Oh, I don't know about you, but Nicodemus needs to slide over, because I need to talk with Jesus as well. It may take me, in the words of Lionel Richie, all night long. Come on, say amen, somebody. You must be born again. Brothers and sisters, we shall do well to observe the time, the place, and the occasion this inquirer came to Jesus in John chapter 3. His name is Nicodemus. The time is night. The place was Jerusalem. The occasion was the feast of the Passover. Catch it now. All day Jesus had been instructing the rude and excited people, plus reasoning with the contentious and conniving scribes all day, testing his divine authority by healing the sick and blind and the lame that were brought to Jesus in great numbers as he spoke. And they were always critical of Jesus. And so when night came on, the crowded city was calm. Jesus needed to seek a place of quiet rest. And he probably went to some retreat on the slope of Mount Olives to get some rest. But no, one was trying to get some rest and another one was coming because he couldn't rest. In other words, he couldn't sleep another night until he had known something more of this wonderful teacher that had come from Galilee. Never man speak like Jesus with such authority. Ah, Nicodemus. Nicodemus, a great master in Israel, a member of the National Council, the Sanhedrin, known to all in Jerusalem for his wealth, for his learning, for his honor, and for his liberality. In fact, the Jewish Talmud speaks of Nicodemus being so rich that he could support a whole city for 10 years on his own resources and could give his daughter Courtney, give his daughter Courtney a dowry of $5 million. Come on. Nicodemus was a man of this high distinction in Jerusalem at that time. He was a doctor of the law, Nicodemus. And many preachers over the years and writers have speculated and have surmised on what led Nicodemus to come to Jesus by night. Why night? What was his motive to coming to Jesus by night? Was he ashamed to be seen with Jesus? Would he excite public curiosity, subjecting him to the kind of remarks and exposure which such a man of his stature would likely shun and would not want to be in the press? Was it because he had met Jesus in the daytime, and if he had met Jesus in the daytime, the noise and interruption of the crowd would prevent anything like a calm and continued conversation? Why night? Or could it have been it was too risky for him to be seen with Jesus in the daylight hour? Should his visit come to the knowledge of his brethren of the Sanhedrin, it would draw upon him their scorn and denunciation from the club. Come on, say amen, somebody. Well, there are many reasons one could speculate, but I suspect, unwilling as men in his position are apt to do, to draw attention either of the rulers or of the rabble-rousers, Nicodemus chose to wait until the crowd had dispersed and then make his way through the quiet streets of the night alone to the place where Jesus had gone to rest for the night. He needed to talk with Jesus. Are there not times when you want to just hush out all the noise, all the distractions, and that you just need to talk with Jesus? Perhaps Nicodemus felt that way. I need to see him. I don't need any interruption. I need my time with Jesus. Get the picture. Catch the scene. In the quiet spot on the slopes of Mount Olivet, the ruler is anxious, agitated, and wandering, trying in vain to put on an air of composure and dignity to make it appear a great act of condescension in him to come at all. And then on the other hand, you have Jesus, lowly, meek, and mild, calm and kind, inspiring his venerable guests with awe and searching every soul with a look. Jesus knows when we come to him. You don't have to really tell him because he already knows. Nicodemus, we are told, felt a strange intimidation in the presence of Jesus. He tried to conceal it with flowery words and greetings to Jesus by saying, "Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher sent from God. None can do these things except God be with him." But notice in his greeting, in his salutation to Jesus, in this night scene in Jerusalem, he did not acknowledge Jesus to be the Messiah, but only a teacher sent from God. That speaks about his unbelief as Jesus being the Messiah. But instead of Jesus recognizing Nicodemus' salutation, see, what I like about Jesus, he cuts right through the chase. He gets right down to the point. Notice, Jesus did not wait for Nicodemus to tell him why he was there. Nowhere do you see where Jesus waited for Nicodemus to go on with his discourse. Jesus cut right through the chase. He said, without any argument, he says, "Verily I say unto you, marvel not, you must be born again." Look at verse 3 through 7. The proliferator says to us that Nicodemus had come to the Lord thinking to enter into a discussion with him. But Jesus laid bare the foundation principles of truth. It is here, he said to Nicodemus, it is not theoretical knowledge you need so much as spiritual regeneration. Let me pause right there. And that's found in the book Desire of Ages, page 171. There are many people in the church who claim to be believers. They have theoretical knowledge. They can pontificate about this scripture and that scripture and about this study and that study, but they have no spiritual regeneration. They have no experiential experience with Jesus. They have all head knowledge and no heart. And Jesus was saying to Nicodemus, it's not enough to just have a theoretical knowledge or to know facts and figures and all of that. You need to know Jesus. You must be born, hey! Again, you don't need your curiosity to be satisfied, Jesus said. What you need is to have a new heart. Oh, I'm speaking to somebody today. Not a heart transplant from some hospital here in Louisville, Kentucky, or wherever you are. Not some some specialist doctor. No. You need a new heart from above. And that's what Jesus was saying to Nicodemus, cutting through the chase. All that you think about, Nicodemus, what you need is a new heart from above. And he says, until this change takes place, you can talk all the smack you want. You can pretend to be religious with your fancy robe and regalia, with your proud vegetarian self, with all your degrees and your position in the church, first elder, second elder, third elder, fourth elder, or whatever number elder you are, unless you receive a new life from above, it won't serve you or any good to discuss with me my authority and my mission, says Jesus. You must be born again. And brothers and sisters, I'm not going to be long with this. I believe after this pandemic is lifted, I believe that the entire church from the pulpit to the pew needs to be born again. Well, I'll wait till somebody say amen. After this pandemic is lifted, I believe that everybody who claims to be a child of God, who claims to be a part of the Magazine Street Seventh Adventist Church, who claims to be a part of God's people, need to be born again. Oh, let me be a little more specific. And as I always used to say, I ain't scared of y'all. Let me be a little more specific. Some stuff after this pandemic needs to be canceled and defunded. Oh, I done gone out in deep waters. I might as well go and swim on the other side. Some stuff, you're talking about defunding the police. There's some things that need to be defunded in the church and counseled in the church. Defunding church programs that are boring, they need to be defunded. Church programs that are stale, they need to be defunded. Church programs that are ineffective, they need to be gotten rid of. Church programs that are irrelevant need to be defunded. Church programs that are inefficient need to be defunded. Church programs that are outdated need to be defunded. And let me go on further and say, we need to counsel out self-righteous people in the church. We need to counsel out those who think they know more than everybody else in the church. We need to counsel out one or two families trying to run the church and been running it all these years. They need to be counseled out. We need to counsel out mean and nasty folk. Yeah, I said it. We need to counsel out gossiping folk, always running around telling tales on somebody, minding other people's business. We need to counsel them out. We need to counsel out rude and disrespectful folk, unloving folk, self-serving folk, closed-minded folk. They need to be counseled out. A new wave, a new usher of people. We need a new vibrancy in the church. I was watching just the other day on Lifetime TV. I happened to run across T.D. Jakes' series entitled Seven Deadly Sins. And this is a series that he's doing that speaks of the seven deadly sins of the Bible. The Bible don't really give you seven specific deadly sins. It speaks about them. That really came under Catholicism. And the seven deadly sins are pride, envy, gluttony, greed, lust, slothfulness, wrath or anger. These things need to be canceled. These things need to be gotten rid of, because the Bible says, blessed are the pure in the heart, they shall see God. You must be born again. And that's why Jesus told Nicodemus, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. By the natures of our hearts, we are all evil. There's no good thing in our heart. Who can know if we are desperately and wicked? Who can know it? No human intervention can remedy the sinning soul. Nothing but the blood of Jesus being born again by the Holy Spirit from above. The prolific writer goes on to say that the Christian life is not a modification or some improvement of the old, but it's really a transformation of nature of the new. Our selfish ways and behavior to sin must die to allow that new life to come spring forth. And this can only be brought about not by how much vegetarian food you eat, not about what kind of clothes you wear, not about how thick and big your Bible is, not about your church attendance and all of that. It can only come by the effectual working of the Holy Spirit. Come on, say amen, somebody. You know, I look back over the days of my life. I can't explain the changes that have come over me, but I know it has happened. And Jesus saying to Nicodemus, just as the wind blows, you can hear it, you can feel it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So it is with everyone that is born of the Spirit. You can't explain how a man who used to drink, all of a sudden, because the Spirit gets a hold of him, he no longer is drunk with alcohol, but he's drunk in the Spirit. You can't explain that. It cannot be explained. But we do know it happens. Everybody and anybody can change when the Holy Spirit gets a hold of that person. And what I like about this story about Nicodemus, and I'm going to come closer now, the story of Nicodemus, life changes. In fact, when you look at Nicodemus after this one night in Jerusalem, it affected his life so much, this encounter with Jesus, that he now becomes a member of the disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was there to help support Jesus and on the cross and making sure he had the proper burial, a proper tomb. Nicodemus. Nicodemus went on to become a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what that says to me, that don't ever judge somebody, because you don't know what the Holy Spirit is doing in that person's life. God can turn them around. He can save from the guttermost to the utmost. He can pick you up. He can turn you around. He can set your feet and my feet on solid ground. Oh, I think when you hear Anthony Wiggum's going to sing this song for us, when you hear this song, Jesus led me all the way, I believe that became Nicodemus' testimony. That Jesus, because of this one night in Jerusalem, not one night in Miami, but this one night in Jerusalem, Nicodemus was affected. And his life was never the same again. Hallelujah! Jesus led him all the way. And if you let him,
someday,
if you let him,
my journey,
he can turn
will be
your night into day. If you let him, if you let him, he can turn your midnights into day. Sing it, Anthony. Sing it, Anthony.
I'll shout while it rings.
Yes, yes, yes.
Heaven's door.
Oh, yes.
That Jesus led me.
I'm so glad he doesn't give up on us. Oh, singing, Anthony, singing, Anthony. Jesus.
Jesus led me on.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
He led me step by step. He stayed.
Step by step, he stayed. Midnight and today. He can turn your sorrow into joy. He can turn your pain into praise. Woo! He can turn your heartache into hope and hallelujah. If you just let him lead you. If you just let him lead you. If you just let him lead you
all the way.
Somebody's feeling me right now. Somebody's feeling this word. All the way. Hey! Step. Step by step. That he can do that. Sing it, Anthony. Woo!
As I lay my burden.
Yes.
Down.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
That
Jesus. Oh, sweet Jesus.
Led me.
That one night in Jerusalem. Listen to this, brothers and sisters, as I close. Surrender and recreation. The blessing comes when, by faith, the soul surrenders itself to God. Then the power, which no human eye can see, creates a new being in the image of God. This is Isaiah, page 173. He can change you. He's still in the changing business. He can meet you wherever you are. Our closing, I'm going to offer prayer, but our closing song each night, each day rather, will be entitled The Midnight Cry. Because soon, this life will be over. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So as I pray with you now, and then we'll close out with that beautiful song of hope, the Midnight Cry. Stay with us throughout the month of May, and I guarantee you, He can turn your midnight, hey, into day. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word today. Thank you that you are able to meet us in the daytime or at night or at noon. It really doesn't matter, because you say, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden. Take my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And I will give you rest unto your soul. You said in your word, he that cometh unto me, I will in no way, no wise cast out. You said in your word, if you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Salvation has come to your house today. He said, when you hear me knocking on the door, if you open up the doors of your heart, I will come in, hey, and sup with you, and you and we with him. Oh God, give us that one night in Jerusalem. Give us that moment where the songwriter says, where the dew upon the roses. He walks with me, he talks with me, and tells me I'm his own. And the joy we shared as we tarried there, none other has ever known. Give me that midnight visitation. Turn my midnights, turn our midnights into day. Bless these subjects each Sabbath that we will bring, that somebody will be lifted, delivered, saved by the power, the regeneration, the renewing of the Holy Spirit in their hearts. Thank you, O God. And when that midnight cry, when we look up, and when we see all around us, hear the angels everywhere, hey,
of a mighty rush,
we'll be able to say, Lord, this is our God, in whom we have waited for,
and
now he will save us. Bless your people, oh God. In the name of Jesus,
I can almost hear,
we pray.
The trumpet.
May you be blessed.
As Gabriel sounds a call.
Oh, yes.
And at the
midnight cry.
Cry,
yeah. Oh, I love this song.
We'll be going home.
It won't be long.
When Jesus
stepped out. Woo!
Gonna cry to call God's children. The dead in Christ.
The dead in Christ shall rise. That remain shall be caught up,
will be quickly changed.
Change in a moment.
Woo. At the midnight,
may this song be a blessing to your soul.
When Jesus comes again,
he is coming back.
How many believe that Jesus is coming back for the church? It's going to make you want to shout. Hallelujah. Oh, I look around me and I see prophecies.
My Lord, my Lord, my Lord. My Lord.
Oh, and signs of the time, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear my Father.
We will.
The bride of Christ will rise when Jesus steps out of the cloud to call God's children. The dead in Christ.
Comes again.
And in those that remain.
Well, beloved, I hope you'll be ready. I want to be ready. My family want to be ready. I hope you'll be ready.
At the midnight cry.
Midnight cry.
When Jesus comes again.
When Jesus comes again. And unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy, the only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. And all of God's children said amen. And remember, he can turn your midnights into day. God bless you.